You're watching Oilers Nation every day with Tyler Yaremchuk. Your one-stop shop for all things Oilers.
The Oilers, I'm not speaking French again. The Oilers win. Let's get into it with the lead. Welcome into the Sports Closet Studio and welcome into Oilers Nation Every Day. Yes, the perfect 12:01 start time, a victory edition of the show as the Oilers take down the Montreal Canadiens in overtime last night. We have a lot to get to today on the program, including our moment of the game, a full game recap, and we're going to look back at the GM meetings. We got Liam's game coming up towards the end of the show, which is your chance to win $25 to Nation Gear. And speaking of Liam's game, Liam, are you there? Hello.
I have arrived.
I thought of a funny idea for the lead right after I hit start on the show.
Well, let's just do it again.
Well, no, because then I'd have to go to another room and get a prop. And yeah. But it was basically, I really like how Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl now have this signature overtime goal celebration. They just snap off the chin strap and act like they don't really care all that much.
Because they've been there and done it. There's one mission this season, Tyler, and it's not winning games in overtime. We should have probably put that game to bed a lot sooner anyway, but that's for us to discuss shortly.
Yeah, that is one where, I mean, the Oilers won with, what would you say, their B-minus game in that one, C-plus?
Yeah, it definitely wasn't great, was it? I mean, the start of the third period really let them down, obviously. But towards the end of the game, like, they're actually maybe a bit unlucky to even send it to overtime with Hyman hitting the post and Nuge, like, barely missing a net on the power play as well. But yeah, probably B-minus at best, right?
Yeah. Okay, well then let's break it down and let's start the breakdown of this game with the scoring summary. It's brought to you by Service Credit Union. The Service Big Share contest is in full swing with your chance to win $1 million just by saving money. Up until the end of April. Anyone can enter by becoming a member and saving with Service. Every $500 you save gets you 5 entries into the Service Big Share contest. Contest ends April 30th, 2024. Skill test required for rules. Visit service.ca/win. The Oilers got on the board first, and they did it in the first half of the first period as well, as Connor McDavid did what, I mean, really only Connor McDavid can do. It's been a while since we've had a true vintage highlight reel McDavid moment, and we got one last night to start the game, Liam, as he cuts and carves his way around a handful of defenders and slides it in. Again, no big selly from Connor McDavid. He knows the time of year we're in right now. Nonetheless, nasty goal.
Yeah, all business for Mr. McDavid. And yeah, it was just one of those great goals. Probably not even in his top 10, though, to be honest. But credit to Evander Kane as well for kind of setting a little bit of a pick there right in front. So he cleared the path for McDavid to go in. But a nice way to start. I really thought this was going to lead into many, many more goals.
Yeah, and I mean, to McDavid's credit, he had another very, very good game in my eyes. He finishes with 2 points on the night. He assisted on Draisaitl's overtime winner as well. But he himself probably just at 5-on-5 alone, if we're being honest, he could have had 3 or 4 goals in that game. He was cutting his way around the ice. He had a look in the second period where Fogle kind of just found him streaking into the zone and he cut in. He had another look right after that first goal as well, where he tried to sneak it past Montembeau through his legs, and it just didn't quite get through. Montembeau just got enough of it to kind of kick it out the back end of his 5-hole. So Connor McDavid was actually absolutely buzzing last night. And today with Carter Hutton, we were debating the MVP talk. I don't think there's really anything Connor McDavid could do down the stretch to put himself ahead of Nathan MacKinnon in the MVP conversation. And quite frankly, I'm not sure if I really care all that much. Because what I care about is him looking as dangerous as he's looked over the last 2 games. Like, that's it. As long as he's still building towards a peak that begins on night one of the playoffs, MVP, no MVP, doesn't matter to me.
Yeah, and I don't think it matters to anyone, to be honest. I don't think McDavid really cares about winning that award. I think the key thing for him and the team is just to be in good form going into the playoffs and down the stretch years. We try and catch Vancouver and also just peel away from LA and Vegas a little bit more too. But I think we said it yesterday or the day before, just like McKinnon's credit. He's had a fantastic season and fully deserves the right to be the front leader for the Hart Trophy. And just to, I guess, answer your little question there too, what would McDavid need to do? Probably have like 40 points in his last like 18 games, truly. Just somehow get past him by a significant margin to win. But again, it doesn't really matter. He'll probably get first place votes anyway, to be honest.
Yeah, he'll probably get a couple. I don't think Nathan McKinnon's winning this thing unanimously. No, I would imagine Kucherov is going to scoop up a couple. I would imagine someone out in Toronto is going to give Austin Matthews some first place vote. I wouldn't be surprised if someone gave Connor Hellebuck first place votes as well. Like, I think there could be as many as five different players getting first place votes in the Hart Trophy conversation, Liam.
Yeah, I fully agree. I don't think this is a lock for anybody right now. It should be interesting. Is actually, for all the awards that are pretty much locked in for many of them, it is interesting that the MVP is so wide open still. It's been a couple of years since we've really seen it like this.
Yeah, I wanted to touch on something you said a little earlier about maybe being a bit unlucky to even go into overtime. You mentioned Zach Hyman hitting the crossbar. There was a lot of weird breaks in that game, and I think they were both positively and negatively impacting the Oilers. Like Connor McDavid on that shot on Montembeau, the second one after he scored his goal. Unlucky that didn't go in. Like, he beat him relatively clean, just needed a bit of a bounce there. But I think you could also look at the goal Connor McDavid did score. Aaron, if we could maybe run that goal back really quickly. I think there's, and they talked about it on the broadcast, the Oilers maybe a little lucky they didn't get dinged for icing on the zone entry right before this. Hyman maybe did, maybe didn't touch it. And then, like you said, Evander Kane makes a sneaky good pick play. I don't think that's ever at a point where they would call it, but still a little bit of a pick play. But that first goal could have never happened if the icing gets called. And that's just a 50-50 play that went the Oilers' way. And you mentioned Hyman hitting the crossbar. I think you could point to that point-blank look Josh Anderson had in the third period. That Pickard, like, just got it with the inside bottom part of his glove and knocked it into himself. Like, there were good and bad breaks in that game. That wasn't a game where I walked away being like, whew, boy, the Oilers easily could have won that one 6-2.
Yeah, and I don't think Montreal are as bad as some of the sports books were giving them yesterday. Like, they do have a lot of good players on that team. Like, Nick Suzuki's been a point-per-game player since the turn of the new year. Slafkovský is kind of slowly becoming that first overall pick that we thought he could be. Like, he had a good assist on that first goal from Suzuki yesterday. And obviously, you have the veterans like Gallagher and Anderson who will give you trouble as well. So, yeah, you're right. Like, it was lucky and unlucky both ways, I guess is a good way to put it. And I think both goaltenders played very well yesterday too. Montembeau is a good up-and-coming goaltender. I think Montreal have a pretty solid one there in their own backyard. Good French boy.
Yeah. I just want to talk a little bit too about their yesterday. What was my key to victory? It was score on the power play and just score a lot, right? Montreal is a team that gives up a ton of goals against on the road. They're a team whose penalty kill is terrible. We're talking like bottom five in the NHL on the road. Oilers score a ton at home. Their power play is absolutely electric at home. And it was disappointing to not see the Oilers come out with a bit of a better offensive effort. You talked about maybe putting that game away a little bit early on. I mean, you had a power play at the end of the second period in the final 3 minutes. You could have made it 3-0. That would have put the game away. Your power play doesn't come through for you there. Early on in the third period, Slafkovský takes a tripping penalty. You could have put the game away there. 3.5 minutes to go in the third. David Savard takes a hooking penalty. You could have put the game away there. Like, to me, just never mind not capitalizing on opportunities, not creating opportunities, I think, was a big problem last night for the Oilers. They didn't feel like they were all that dangerous in the offensive zone unless it was Connor McDavid doing it all himself. And that's, again, a win's a win. I'm not going to sit here and overly nitpick this game, but the numbers back up what we saw last night, or what I feel like I saw in the game. At 5-on-5, according to Natural Stat Trick, they had a 1.43 expected goals for at 5-on-5. That is the lowest number in their last five games. They only had 16 5-on-5 scoring chances. The last time they had a number that low, it was 14 games ago. It was the game in Dallas that they won in overtime. And they actually haven't had a game this season with fewer than 16 5-on-5 scoring chances for. So that was, honestly, one of the weakest offensive performances we've seen from the Oilers. It is great that they came away with a win, but that wasn't, you know, when they beat the Habs 2-1 back in January or February or whatever, it was very clear Sam Montembeau made that a 2-1 overtime win. Like, it could have been 5-6-1 for the Oilers that night if it wasn't for Montembeau. Last night, I didn't get that vibe at all. I didn't feel like the Oilers, and I would have liked to see it, just pedal down and just dominate a team that gives up a lot of goals. We didn't get that.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up the offense, and because my key to victory was get key contributions from all four lines. And it kind of felt like we were getting that right off the start, like Sam Karagas in a fight, it's just a bit of a tone, like Henrique scored. But I thought that second line was fairly quiet last night. And really, outside of the goal Henrique got, like, that third line didn't do a lot either. And they were on the ice for the Suzuki goal, which wasn't great by any means to come out in the first 30 seconds and score. I know we're going to get to this a bit later, but the lines are very curious to me at the moment, because it feels like that third line is becoming a bit of a black hole is the wrong way to put it. I think ultimately they'll be fine, but you would just like to see a little bit more from them. I know they got the goal yesterday, but I need to see more, and I don't know what the solution is, because I also don't think it's putting Ryan Nugent-Hopkins down there.
Yeah, so that's something that came down. Obviously, they didn't do it at skate the other day. They decided on it right for warm-ups. So Evander Kane goes up to the top line. Oh, Liam's gone. We'll reconnect with Liam in a second. They go back to Evander Kane on the top line. And honestly, it puzzled me. I think you could have kept rolling with the same 12 forwards that you had for the last couple of games here. Let Henrique, Brown, and Kane try to develop some sort of chemistry in that for a decent stretch. Again, they played together for, what, 2.5 games? I feel like they could have given them a little bit more runway. They don't, and we talked about this yesterday on pre-gaming when I was on with Aaron, but the issue with Henrique Brown and Evander Kane was none of them go out there and are particularly good off the rush, and that's kind of where they struggled. They weren't getting looks because they weren't attacking the zone with any speed. They weren't getting a chance to set up. There wasn't enough speed there. Well, putting Nugent and Derek Ryan on Henrique's wings, that's not giving them a lot of speed either.
No, I wonder if Ryan McLeod can be a solution on that third line. I know I love that second line. I don't want it to get broken up, but at the end of the day, you can keep Kane on the first line. You know it works. You can put Nuge on that second line with Draisaitl and Fogel, and it should be fine. Having that speed element, I wouldn't have Derek Ryan there much longer. I'd rather just have Perry. At least he has a scoring instinct. Maybe that's what you do there. Henrique, I don't know. You got to keep him there, right? You got to just find those line mates that make it work. And now what if they got like 17, 16 games to figure it out? So I would break up that second line if it means adding to the third line. I just wouldn't put McLeod as a centerman.
I'll tell you the solution. It's take Derek Ryan out, call up Dylan Holloway, and boom, you have a third line with some speed and scoring touch. The top line is fine. Like yesterday, their numbers were good. You noticed a lot of chances. Evander Kane had a really good look early in that game. I think he finished the game with 3 or 4 shots on goal, picked up one in overtime. That first line will work. Even if it's Connor McDavid carrying it, which last night I felt like it was, it'll work. That second line we know can work. It's all about just trying to piece together a third line that can actually push play for you. With Henrique and Nuge on the ice, you're covered defensively. I think that's a great duo to slide Dylan Holloway next to, even if it involves flipping Nuge to the right side where he doesn't play a lot. He can get used to that. I think Nuge is a smart enough player where you can play him anywhere on the ice. I would go Holloway, Henrique, Nuge on the third line. But again, I'm okay with keeping Holloway down in Bakersfield for another 5-6 games, letting him play a ton and going from there.
I would keep Holloway in Bakersfield until the end of the month. And then I think, just think that's enough runway for everybody. Holloway should be up to a good standard in his offensive game by that point, which he is on track to be on that as well. You give Henrique another few weeks. You just give everyone some time to continue to gel here. And then like the Oilers aren't in a position that it's like so desperate that they need to make a change to this today. But I think in like 10 days, 11 days, whatever it would be to the end of the month, that's probably when you can find a solution.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Let's get to our moment of the game, Liam. I slept like a baby last night on my Douglas mattress, and it's loved by more than 200,000 Canadians. A lot of people are sleeping good on their Douglas mattresses, and I bet you Adam Henrique slept good last night. Our moment of the game brought to you by Douglas Mattress. You can order today, mattdouglas.ca/OilersNation. Oh, my voice almost came out of me there, Liam. Every mattress order comes with a free comfort sleep bundle. You get two memory foam pillows with pillow protectors, one luxurious cotton sheet set, and one mattress protector free with any mattress order. Order today, Douglas.ca/OilersNation. Their mattresses are handcrafted in Canada, and you'll be supporting a locally owned and operated Edmonton company. Adam Henrique finds the back of the net, Liam.
Yeah, he does. And it wasn't a pretty goal by any means, but he found a way to get in on the second swipe of things. But just a great play by Yaremchuk in the corner to come away with the puck, get it to the more offensively gifted Evan Bouchard, and Ekholm found Henry right on the doorstep. A goal the Oilers really needed at this point in the game, I think, just to peel away a little bit more. Ultimately, that's Montreal came back and found a way. But I'm sure Henrique felt pretty relieved to see this one going to back of the net too.
Yeah, you could see the smile on his face. He had a big grin. It was nice to see Carrick go out, have the scrap, make a bit of an impact there. Henrique finds the back of the net. And I think that's, you said it's not pretty. That's how Adam Henrique's going to score, though. This isn't a guy who's, you know, coming in and firing home a one-timer that goes bar down or something like that. He has a good nose for the net. That was the book on Henrique coming in. So not surprising to see him score a goal from literally right inside the blue paint. And this is what you're looking at now through his first six games as an Oiler: a goal, an assist, averaging 15 minutes time on ice. I actually expect that number to maybe go up a little bit over the next while as they start to play him a bit more at 5-on-5, and more importantly, play him a little bit more on the PK. So Henrique, again, it's nice to see him get that bit of production. If he can bang home a couple of more, say over his next five games, and he's sitting with three goals in his first 10 or 11, I think that eases a lot of pressure on him. As much as the Oilers didn't bring him in here to be an offensive juggernaut, you did still pay a first round pick for the guy. You'd like to see some element of scoring juiced into the lineup. And I think if he has three goals every 10 games kind of thing and keeps going with the good defensive play, there's going to be no complaints about Adam Henrique in amongst nation citizens.
No, I completely agree. He's not come in here to be a top six winger. He's coming here to be a shutdown third liner. And I think someone said it in the chat before when we were talking about the lines. We'll probably see the best of him in the playoffs when he can go out against the top other team's top line and give Draisaitl and McDavid better opponents too. So I've been happy with him the last couple of games. I think things do need to continue to trend in a positive direction, but he also needs to find some line mates to help him do that.
Adam Henrique finds the back of the net. The monkey is off the back, you could say. His first goal in his sixth game with the Edmonton Oilers. Our moment of the game brought to you by Douglas Mattress. Order today at Douglas.ca/OilersNation. And that order, it's going to come with a free comfort sleep bundle. I have been neglecting the Charm Diamond Center's YouTube chat, Liam, so I want to get in to what the people are saying. Charm Diamond Center's proudly Canadian-owned and operated, and you can get a custom ring built and delivered in less than 4 weeks with the Charm Masterpiece program and an unbeatable pricing policy. And of course, you know, I love Charm Diamonds a lot. They help me out big time. And I love to see that bagged milk has turned it into a meme. Aaron, you got the photo. Very creative bagged milk. Very funny. Anyway, shout out to Charm Diamond Centers. Let's go into the YouTube chat where Sean H is in. He was the first comment of the day. He says, I like Stetcher. I don't mind Kane on the top line right now. Swap Perry and Brown and we're good. Getting playoff ready. I thought Troy Stetcher, if we want to dissect this one at a time, I thought Troy Stetcher was fine last night, had good moments, does some nice things. I'm through two games. I'm not itching to keep him in the lineup over Vinny, though.
Oh, no, me neither. He had a really good rush in the first period, I think it was, which was like, oh, this is what Quads was talking about. But you didn't really see that too much, but I'm fine with it. He was better than last game. So I think that's a positive. I'm fine with him just being the seventh defenseman and coming in when we need him.
Yeah, Rusty, I can't wait to freak out about an OT win. It's going to be so much fun. I mean, it's great that they got the win. They also needed a four-minute power play in overtime and needed right up until the end of that four-minute power play to finish it off. Like, it wasn't a Picasso at all, but a win is a win for the Oilers. Disappointing they couldn't get some help on the out-of-town scoreboard is something else I would add into the mix here. Ryder was talking about... Oh, go ahead.
They did a little bit. Vegas lost.
Yeah, I'm seeing... I'm not even that worried about the Oilers staying ahead of Vegas and LA right now. Like, I think at this point in the year, that's kind of a given. You're five up on the Kings and you have two games in hand. You're seven up on the Golden Knights and you have two games in hand. Like, you, if the Oilers in their final 16 games would have to go like 4-12 for either Vegas or LA to have a realistic chance at catching them, and that's not going to happen.
Will you admit now that there is a playoff race in the Western Conference? Minnesota is 3 points back. Granted, Vegas does have a game in hand.
Yeah, so, I mean, even if they were to lose that game in hand, 3 points back, 13 games to go, definitely not impossible. I'm not saying that, and Vegas has to get going right away. I just think at some point here, this Vegas team is talented enough where they'll scoop up 3-4 straight wins, and they'll just put this thing to bed. That's still how I view it. And also, I mean, Minnesota 6-2-2 in their last 10, that's good. They need to play at a better pace than 6-2-2, though, over their next 10 if they want to stay in the hunt. And I think that's asking a lot.
They also play each other twice. So yeah, that's interesting. Yeah. We'll see.
Two game sevens for the Minnesota Wild is how you have to view that. Basically, if they win them both, you're good. If not, you're cooked.
Yeah, 100%. I think they actually might both be in the one at home, home and home.
Ryder talking about Sam Carrick says, buy a house, get out of the hotel. You're going to be re-signing. Dackey says, Carrick has been bringing some of the energy we want. Now, only if he had the cost and charisma to boot. I mean, he really is. And I was texting our pal Luke Gazdick about him yesterday. I was like, man, Sam Carrick really is exactly what this team needed for a fourth line center. Again, a minor role on the team, but they've been doing interesting stuff with him. If it's a right side face-off, they've thrown him out there a couple times with McDavid and Draisaitl. The wind draws, and then he just comes straight off the ice. Like, I don't know. I like the way they're using Carrick. I like the impact that he's making. He's confident enough to make plays with the puck as well. So, yeah, I'm loving what I'm seeing from Carrick. Sean said that, too. He said, love Carrick. If Nuge is staying on the third, need some grit on the third, move Perry up. Carrick has the fourth line covered. So now we want Perry moved up, not swapped with Brown. Interesting.
We're kind of everywhere with him, aren't we?
Yeah, we're kind of a little everywhere, but I'm loving what we're seeing from Carrick. I would do 2 years, $1 million a season with Sam Carrick if it was up to me. Continuing along, I'm going to get to what you guys are saying a little bit more recently here in the chat. Bob says Carrick is fire. I'd like to see Kane play 100 every game. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I thought Evander Kane was fine yesterday. I don't think that he was an issue at all. Had a couple of good looks.
Thought he was solid.
Yep.
Thought he had a really good chance in the first period there. He drew the penalty late in the game. What more do you want? Obviously, a goal would be great, but I thought he had a good game.
People calling me a closet Vegas fan. Sure, I guess. But no, I don't know, man. Like, I still think it's more likely than not they catch LA, and that's just because I'm not very high on LA. But with that being said, I would much rather face the LA Kings than the Vegas Golden Knights in round one. We talked about this yesterday on Oilers Nation Radio.
Yeah, I would rather they played LA as well. I think the goaltending is the biggest difference for me. I'd rather face David Rittich than Aiden Hill.
Yeah, 1,000%. Jack is in and says, solid is the best word for Kane. Nothing amazing, nothing bad. Underrated, in my opinion. So. I think that's fine, but I also think the argument against it, Jack, would be he makes $5.125 million, and we know how good he can be when he's on. We just don't see it enough.
Yeah, but I think we saw it. We don't see it enough. There's no doubt about that. It's been like a month since he scored a goal now, but the small contributions here and there are good. He just seems like that guy who, once he scores, we all know he's gonna put home a few over a little bit of a strike. Like, he hit the crossbar against Colorado. His chances are coming. So hopefully the goose egg breaks soon.
Yep, that's fair. Evander Kane, you see it enough. Relax. When was the last time Evander Kane scored a goal?
February 19th.
That's what, 15, 16 games?
Yeah, probably about that. A month. About a month.
Yeah, it's been a month. So, no, I think, you know,
you need more.
Same thing we got on Warren Fogle for last year, and he made half the amount of money. Like, I want to see more consistent offensive production from a guy I'm paying north of $5 million for. And I think sometimes, you know, when a guy like Nuge maybe isn't contributing as much as you'd like, you can at least sit there and be like, hey, good defensively, helps out on the penalty kill. And it's like, yeah, like, still bringing value. I think the problem for Evander Kane when you evaluate his game is the hits, good, sure, yes, that's fine. Even if some of them are, no, I'm not going to, but I think you need the goals. The reason you're paying him 5.1 is to get goals. The reason you're paying Nuge north of $5 million is, yeah, scores a bit on the power play, can generate a little bit of 5-on-5 offense, good defensively, good on the PK, covers different areas. Kane gets paid to score goals. He needs to score more goals.
Yeah, I completely agree. Completely agree.
Yep. All right, let's keep cruising along here on the show. We got our moment of the game done. We got the scoring summary done as well. It is kind of interesting, Liam, to look at the Oilers' schedule over the last little bit in the month of March. Like, it doesn't feel like they've had a particularly dominant month of March. But then you kind of go through the games, and it's like, man, they're 4-5. They're 6-1-2. This doesn't feel like a 6-1-2 kind of month.
How many regulation losses do they have in the last little bit? Obviously, Columbus was one. I can't recall Columbus the one before that.
So you got to go back to February, and it would be the 6-3 loss to the Flames in the BOA.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's kind of wild, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, I completely agree. I don't think they've played their best hockey by any means consistently, but you look through those wins. That Seattle game was a tight one. Skinner showed up for it. The Bruins game, the Pittsburgh game, they dominated. The Bruins game was a fantastic game in Boston where they stuck in it all the way. Battle of strikes there against Columbus and Buffalo, bounced back against Pittsburgh in like a weird way, but found a way to win despite allowing 40 shots. And then Washington, you dominate. Great game against Colorado, just entertainment value. And then yesterday, a bit of a letdown, but you still find a way. But I think one thing too that maybe is overshadowed sometimes when these games come after such a high energy game, the next one up, maybe you don't have everything in you because you put so much into the previous one, right? Like getting up for a Colorado game towards the end of the season compared to getting up to a game against Montreal is a lot different. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah, so they're 8-1-2 in their last 11 to give you the full scope of things. But before that, they had obviously lost to the Calgary Flames in regulation, and they lost to the Minnesota Wild the night before, too. So it was back-to-back. Actually, there was a little stretch there where the Oilers had lost three straight games, right? 6-5 to Boston in OT, then 4-2 to Minnie, 6-3 to Calgary. So it was a tough stretch, but they bounced back by going 8-1-2, which I think is something this team's done very well so far this season. Now they'll roll into a game tomorrow, still on home ice before a little Eastern road trip, and they get a chance to play another non-playoff team in the Buffalo Sabres, who have been just wildly inconsistent so far this year. They either look like a team who is like a legit playoff contender, or they look like a bottom feeder, and there is rarely ever an in-between for this Sabres group.
I know. It's so true. I love so many players on this team. Dylan Cousins, Bowen Byram now, the goalie. How do you say his name?
Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen.
I love him too. So, yeah, you don't know what you're going to get. And I guess that's what happens when you have such a young team, right? Like, you're going to have those ebbs and flows. But I think the Oilers should actually want to get up for this one pretty bad with how poorly they played in Buffalo the other week. It's a reasonable time of not 10:30 in the morning on a Sunday or Saturday, whatever it was. So this Buffalo team, while they're fighting for a playoff spot, you don't know what to expect. That same Washington team the other week was in a similar spot to them, and the Oilers handled them fairly well. So hopefully they can just do the same against Buffalo tomorrow and come home with a better than a B-minus game.
Let's wrap up the game recap here with our Sounds of the Oil, the segment presented by Snow Valley Aerial Park and Rainbow Valley Campground. Lots going on this summer out at the Snow Valley Aerial Park. The park opens up on May 31st. They got the White Mud Creek Mining Company, Target Golf going up the ski hill, and the all-new mini golf. Plenty of fun for the entire family. If you're from out of the city, you want to get in, do a little camping right in the heart of Edmonton, you can take advantage of the over 60 sites and 3 comfort camping domes at the Rainbow Valley Campground. Online bookings are opening soon. Head to rainbow-valley.com for more information. Adam Henrique, speaking to the media after the game on how he's feeling about his game, he said, quote, "I felt like my game has been good. Of course, you want to score coming into a new team. You want to find a way to contribute. But I think for me, the focus is you want the complete game to be there. We've had some high tempo games, and I felt great in those games, making sure I'm adjusting well to the system. The guys have done a great job talking me through everything, so I felt like my game was there. It's certainly nice to get on the board tonight We can't give up the first one in the third period. I thought the first shift as a line. So yeah, it's interesting. He brought up that first goal in the third as a moment he looked back on just as much as the goal. Cause at the end of the day, that's what he's paid here to do. I'm sure he's thrilled. He was on the ice to score one, but he was also for the first time as an Oiler on the ice for a 5-on-5 goal against.
Yeah. I went back and watched that goal and I wouldn't put any of the blame on Adam Henrique in that sequence, to be honest. Like, Nugent Hopkins keep the play alive in the offensive zone. Sorry. Derek Ryan loses a battle, I think it was, and the puck comes back the other way. And it seemed like Derek Ryan just let Slavkovsky just skate right by him, if I'm remembering correctly. And then Cody Ceci loses a battle in front. Yeah, a bit unfortunate, but just a brutal way to start a period, to be honest. Like, you're pointing out that group, and it's supposed to be the defensive group, I guess you could call it. You'll see it here. Like, Derek Ryan kind of just stops skating and stops following his guy, and then all of a sudden he's gone, and then boom, in the back of the net. Am I wrong?
Not being quick enough as well. Might be like a zone man-to-man thing too on that one. So it wasn't a great moment.
Yeah, it just seems weird because you look and it's like, okay, well, there's an extra guy there, and even if it's a bit of a zone, like, surely you could see that, like, whoever the defenseman there was, I think it was cool, like, needs a bit of support, right? And you can see Henrique kind of come in towards the end and give what he can, but play's already gone at that point. I think it was a bit unlucky from CC as well. He does actually box out Suzuki fairly well, and he goes off Suzuki's back foot. Like, that's a bit unfortunate. And of course it was Cody CC too, of course.
Had to be. I would say that too. Like, it bounced off Suzuki's front skate and then his back skate and then went in, or whatever the close-up replay showed. Like,
yeah,
if that puck is an inch either way off his front skate, we're not even talking about this play, right? So I'm not going to get too hard on the third line for that one, because again, you're a bounce away from that being an irrelevant play for the game. But still, I like your point, just coming into the zone. If you have someone who's maybe a little bit quicker than Derek Ryan who can keep up with that guy coming in, maybe that chance doesn't even happen and you're not sitting here wishing for a good bounce or a positive bounce to get out of it. There is our Sounds of the Oil, delivered by the Snow Valley Aerial Park and the Rainbow Valley Campground. Liam, let's head into the back half of the show. Should we do a little GM meetings update? Is that next?
That can be next, but I have a question about Snow Valley and Rainbow Valley.
Camp.
Did you say camping domes?
Yeah, they call them comfort camping domes. So I think you just, like, you don't need to pack your tent and stuff. You just go there awesome. And they got a cool little dome for you to stay in.
I think we've got a nice day ahead of us coming up this May, Tyler. A little aerial park, some target golf, and then maybe we can go camping.
Just the two, or maybe we can do the show from a comfort camping dome.
That would be incredible. That would be amazing.
Snow Valley, hook us up.
I'm in.
Okay, let's talk a little bit of the GM meetings. Our GM meetings recap is brought to you by Star Mechanical, Edmonton's number one plumbing and heating company. It's been that way for more than 20 years. They offer 24/7 emergency services. And if you want to find out more, you can visit them at starmechanical.ca to schedule an appointment and let them help you keep your home running smoothly. Frank Saravalli with a couple of tweets. He's going to join us on Friday's show, by the way. He says the NHL's latest projection for hockey-related revenue is $6.2 billion, according to Gary Bettman. He also added, and both Bettman and Deputy Commissioner Bill Daly were speaking at the press conference, about the Arizona Coyotes. Bill Daly says he does not believe a June land auction date for the Coyotes arena would allow the league enough time to pivot for relocation ahead of next season. That would lead you to believe the league's okay with staying in Arizona for another year and keeping the Yotes at the Mullet Arena for the 2024-25 season. He then, though, in the second half of Frank's tweet, says Daly declined to clarify if that means the league needs to make a call on Arizona before that date. That second part is what tells me everything we need to know.
Yeah, it seems like every time we get an Arizona update, there's something they don't want to comment on, or there's something that's changed slightly. We went to the Mullet and it was awesome. It's a super cool place to like watch hockey and everything, but also it's not a great place that NHL players want to go and play, right? Like, I just don't see how this is a good thing just for the Yotes organization as a whole too, right? To like try and attract players and all of that. But hey, come play now. our college rink, which actually doesn't have our logo in the middle of the ice. There's just so many layers to this, which is so pathetic by the NHL. I don't think any other league in the world would allow this to continue to happen and just realize a mistake has been made and we need to kind of move on from this franchise and try them in a different city. If it's Utah, Portland, Quebec City, wherever it may be, just let somebody else try and make this work, because Arizona has done nothing to prove they can do it right.
McDiesel is in. People need to leave the Yotes alone. They got better jerseys than 30 other teams, including the Leaves. Well, there you go.
There you go.
No reason to move them now.
I mean, accurate point. I'll give him that. The jerseys are cool.
The Kachina's cool. I like the Kachina look, but come on. Cool jerseys. That's great. They also should probably be playing in an arena that's not meant for a second-tier college team, right?
Yeah. And here's another layer of the mullet arena that people aren't talking about enough. You can't even walk all the way around the main concourse. Halfway through, it's on the benches side. There's like business, like it's their suites and everything. They're luxury suites, whatever you want to call them. And you can't even walk through. You have to walk all the way around, and then everything just bottlenecks into this little part. Like, it's cool to watch, but everything else actually isn't that great.
OJ says, should have played in Quebec. Utah's the better spot to put a team. If you're going to move them, like, I don't know. You need to get a big media market behind it. You need big corporate sponsorship. And that's always been the problem with putting a team in Quebec City. So maybe when the NHL expands to 34, but in terms of relocation, it's Utah or it is nothing. The league also put out, and I know we talked about this a little bit yesterday, but the league did put out their minor rule changes for next year. I think we have a couple of them that we can kind of flash up here. Goalies can now get a penalty for intentionally dislodging the net. Some stuff with faceoffs. The one that, if a goalie is pulled by the concussion spotter / injury replacement, the goalie gets a warm-up. That's okay. Interesting. So let's say that game against Pittsburgh. Calvin Pickard, with a minute and a half to go in the period, gets pulled out by the concussion spotter. 2 minutes to go in the period. Stuart Skinner comes in. With this new rule, Stuart Skinner would get a warm-up. Now, I remember back in, I think the AJHL used to do this, Liam, where for preseason games, when they would do like the, hey, we're going to have a goalie play half the game, they would pause the game at the halfway point and bring out some pucks and do like a little two-minute goalie takes a handful of wrist shots and gets warmed up. My point with this is, if the goalie gets a warm-up, like, how long was Calvin Pickard gone for? 4 minutes? If we're going to do a two-minute commercial break and then come back, isn't it just kind of a massive waste of time?
Yeah, that seems a bit weird to allow him to take, like, shots and everything. It's unfortunate that goalie has to go in, but also, if a goalie gets pulled mid-game, that goalie coming in doesn't get to face some shots before he gets some opportunities, right, against opponents. But, yeah, I don't know. I don't like that at all. Just, we need to speed the game up. We need to get rid of half these reviews, and we can't just now put in a practice for a goalie. Because, like, I mean, how rarely is this happening? We've seen it once this season, of course, and like that is what it is. Like, one thing I would maybe push for is maybe they can come out a couple of minutes before the start of a period and get warmed up then. I don't think you can just do this mid-game, though.
It is weird. I think so. The difference between like when you pull a goalie because he gave up 4 goals, like, you're making that choice. Part of the risk there is you're putting in, hey, you want to pull your goalie? Yeah, you can throw in the other guy. He's coming in cold, though. I think with this, it's because you're forcing them to switch goalies is the reason you'd give them the warm-up. But it slows down the game. Jake is in the chat, 4-hour games incoming. I mean, no. This happens, what, 2-3 times a year a goalie gets pulled out for the concussion spotter. So there will be 2 or 3 games a year that are 3 minutes longer.
Maynard made a good point. Sorry. Where is it? I never knew a goalie pushing the net off wasn't a penalty already. I actually thought that was a penalty.
Yeah, I thought it was too. So that was interesting. This one's huge. If a goalie loses his mask, the other team gets an offensive zone draw with their choice of dot. Massive. I love how these things come up. Like, who sat there and was like, hey, when a goalie loses his mask, can the offensive team pick what side of the ice the faceoff's on? Who's like, why? I don't know. It's just weird.
Such a small thing. for sure. Like, it's, I mean, sure, I guess, like, it makes sense.
Yeah.
But the one I'm very curious about, and I'm sure this was a topic of conversation in these meetings, the Department of Player Safety, like, how is that going to change? Because it's not been very good, and it feels fairly inconsistent the last few years, and we saw it right perfectly in the playoffs where Petrangelo and Nurse got the same punishment for two very different things. I'm very curious what kind of comes out from that this week, if anything.
Nothing. They kind of said they're good. Peros came out and talked about it.
Did he really? Well, yeah. Great. I'm glad we're improving where faceoffs go, though.
I want to get to this because someone's yelling at us in the chat to read this comment from Nick. What if the teams play it like an extra timeout? The concussion spotter is independent from the teams. He is a league employee. There is no team affiliation there, so you don't have to worry about that. Teams are not going to be intentionally concussing their starting goaltenders to get a second timeout. You're good on that front. You're good. That will not happen. It has nothing to do with the teams. They don't. Do you think the Oilers sat there and were like, we're going to pull out Pickard for 2 minutes and ruin his shutout to get the concussion spotter? So you're good. No need to. Vegas isn't going to do it. You're fine.
They might.
Calm down, everybody. Frank Saravalli wrote a piece talking about professionalizing the e-bug. I kind of wanted to talk about that, but I think we can save it for Friday when Frank is actually on the show. Let's keep cruising along. It is Wednesday, which means it is time for Liam's game. If you don't know it, well, you're about to love it. Basically, two mystery players. The first one is an easy one, right? Liam gives you your clues. If you're the first person to guess the easy one in the YouTube chat, you're entered into a draw. We then have our more difficult one. If you're one of the first three people to get the more difficult player, boom, you pop into the draw. Four people in the draw, one person wins $25 to Nation Gear. Shout out to nationgear.ca, which right now still has the Robin Brownlee Memorial Auction up. And this week's prize, if you're a fan of the show, you're going to like this one. Also, I just saw that another top bid went up. It is the Oilersnation Everyday experience. You get to pick your day. You get to come into the studio, see our offices, hang out with us. And then, as I promised yesterday on Oilersnation Radio, you get to be on the show. You get to sit on the couch next to Liam, and you get to be on the show for an hour. How about that for an auction prize?
What could be better? An Oilersnation Everyday experience. There's not a lot to it, but you'll love it.
You get to be on the show, and then we'll take you down to Dog Patch after the bar that's right below our studio, and we'll buy you lunch, buy you a beer. How about that?
You can ask us anything.
You can ask us anything. You get to learn the behind-the-scenes workings of everything. And, of course, all the proceeds from this going to support Robin Brownlee's family as well. So it's all for a great cause. Get your bid in at nationgear.ca, the last one we're doing when it comes to the Robin Brownlee Memorial Auction. So, Liam's game, $25 in Nation Gear up for grabs. Let's go.
All right, Aaron, bring on the first one. I played 7 seasons for the Oilers, played for 2 NHL teams. I played just shy of 500 games. I had just over 160 points in my career. My draft round doesn't exist anymore. So this is the easy one, folks.
This is the easy one.
This is the easy one. Let me get my Wheel of Fortune on.
And remember, these players played for the Oilers, and they played for the Oilers after the year 2000, correct?
Yes. So we all should be old enough.
We all should be old enough.
Sergeant Battle, who is a young boy.
Liam, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know how easy this one is. 7 seasons for the Oilers. These are just very vague.
Okay, I'll give you another. I know I'm trying not to be too vague, but I can't give too much away. He only played 8 seasons in the NHL and played for 2 teams, and 7 of the seasons were with Edmonton.
Ooh. Oh, I think I know who it is.
Okay. God damn it. I'm here verbally.
Your mic just wants to turn off.
My
2
camera.
Seasons.
There we go.
There's the other team.
I'm surprised this has stumped people. The second one is significantly more difficult.
All right. Well, I got it. I know who it is 100%. I'm looking to see. No one in the chat has gotten this one yet.
Okay. So here's some.
He's from the Edmonton area. How about that?
Was his career cut short?
I don't think so.
No.
Okay. Maybe.
Maybe. So the draft, what I mean by the last one is when he was drafted, there was more than seven rounds. So he was picked later than the seventh round.
Edmonton product.
Edmonton guy. You all loved him on one particular playoff run. There it is. We got it. Thank goodness. Fernando Pisani, people.
Shout out to Saber Cove. You're getting in the draw.
Oh, Saber Cove. Jeez, Saber I didn't Cove. Think that was going to be such a struggle, if I have to be honest.
It took me a second to really clue into it. It took until you said that, you know, again, he only played 8 years in the league. Then I was like, ah, yeah, that would make sense.
I should really be more specific on the easy ones, I think.
Mm-hmm. All right, okay. Let's get to the difficult one for our friends at Nation Gear, part two of Liam's game.
The second one, I'll admit, I forgot what this guy was called. I had to look it up again. I played in 659 NHL games. I was drafted by an expansion team. I played two seasons in Edmonton. I played for six NHL teams. I am a former U of A Golden Bear.
Who are the Golden Bears who have played for the Oilers? Bob Stauffer is going to kill me for not knowing this.
Not going to like this one, but he'll like me for bringing it up.
It's not Derek Ryan.
No, Derek Ryan wasn't drafted.
Yeah. Interesting. Drafted by... So wait, when you say drafted by an expansion team, you're talking about like...
See, so he was drafted in a supplemental draft.
Okay. Two seasons in Edmonton. Played for six NHL teams.
Mm-hmm.
Former U of A Golden Bear.
I believe he's not from Edmonton. He's from Alberta, but not from Edmonton. I think he was a defenseman.
You think?
I forgot his name before I before the segment. Matt Boleyn. Ooh, sneaky.
Sneaky. He did not play for six other NHL teams, though. Sadly. Oh man. That's
nothing, eh? Well, three people have it in the chat.
Three people have it in the chat. Oh, are a bunch of people getting it now?
Yeah, a few people have got it now. I think we're closing the bid, and I got my three.
You got your three? We're closing it off. Liam, who is the right answer?
The correct answer was Corey Cross. He was the first overall pick in the 1992 supplemental draft by the Tampa Bay Lightning. Straight out of the U of A, he was picked.
That's impressive. That doesn't happen.
He might be one of one.
Yeah.
One of very few.
Because of its supplemental draft, yeah. There you go. Corey Cross is your answer. Liam, who are our four?
The four were Saber Cove, OJ Gaze, Maddie 39, Smurfy 999. And here we go.
Saber Cove. Email me, Tyler@thenationnetwork.com, and say, I am Saber Cove and I want my prize. And I'll get you hooked up with $25 to Nation Gear. Let's keep cruising along with the show and get to the menu for our friends at DoorDash. 25% off and zero delivery fees on your first order of $15 or more. All you need to do is download the DoorDash app and enter the promo code Nation25. You can even take advantage of the Double Dash feature, Liam, which allows you to add a second stop onto your DoorDash order for zero extra delivery fees. Dash that for the win with DoorDash. Liam, the menu, new episode of Better Late Than Never with our boy Bagged Milk, and I think some exciting stuff coming on at the website. I have an article up about three or four ways the Oilers could create more cap space this summer. You can read that at OilersNation.com once you're done watching this show. Post-game reaction as well, and you have a new article in your series called The Tape.
Yes, so The Tape is a shift-by-shift analysis of one player. I haven't decided who I'm going to do from yesterday yet. Maybe Henrique, since he got his first goal. But if you want to go back and look, I did one on Connor Brown and his game against the Washington Capitals the other week, too. So stay tuned.
Always good stuff popping up over at OilersNation.com for you to read and kill some company time. Shout out to our friends at DoorDash for the menu. Let's wrap up with a little bit of talk about our Betway bets, Liam, because I got some gloating to do. With our friends at Betway, you can get a free bet up to $200 if your first bet loses. Oh my God.
He's gone.
Liam, I'm losing my voice.
I don't have the ad read, but if you scan
the QR code and redeem your bonus, place a bet, no minimum amount required. And if the bet loses, you'll get a refund up to $200. You can then use that money to bet on your favorite sports. This offer is only available to people outside of Ontario. I hit my bet yesterday with the OT winner, McDavid power play point.
I also hit my bet yesterday, which was Connor McDavid to get a goal and assist at +150. So I'm sneaking ahead, just creeping a little bit closer to that victory line, I think. You're going to get more ambitious with your picks, though. You admit it yesterday. If you want to get close to even passing Jay, who I believe also lost.
He lost, so I gained a unit. He lost a unit, so a two-unit swing.
That's big. But again, you've got to look at a bit of a home run here, Tyler. I think you can't just be this diddly-daddly-in.
I will pick my spot. Don't you worry. There you go. Shout out to our friends at Betway again. Free bet up to $200 if your first bet loses. Place a bet, no minimum amount required. And if the bet loses, you'll get a refund up to $200. This offer only available outside of Ontario. Liam, I wanted to give some love to a cool moment on Twitter. Our friends at the Sports Closet helping out Russ Jericho. He shared a great DM. He was looking for an Oilers toque with the Heritage Classic logo on it. Sports Closet reached out to him and were like, hey, we have a couple of them left. We'll set it aside for you. And Russ got hooked up with his new lid.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. And it just goes to show that like Sports Closet actually does listen. If you go in and make a request and stuff, they'll go out that way to show what their customer service is all about. I've gone in there a few times. They've also done this for my mom once before too, when she was looking for a Christmas gift. She left a callback number and they called and let her know the information she needed. So it's great down at the Sports Closet, Sherwood Park, St. Albert, Kingsway, all over.
The best part about going and shopping at a local sports shop like that is like they have the ability to do stuff like order. You know, when you're talking to someone, it's an employee who has the ability to actually help you out and go the extra mile. So a big, big shout out. Wanted to give some love to our friends at the Sports Closet, Liam. That is a wrap on today's edition of the program. Tomorrow, another Sherwood Ford Giant Game Day edition of the show. Jay should be around for that bad boy as well. So giddy up. Shout out Sherwood Ford the Giant. We'll dig into things tomorrow, Liam. The Buffalo Sabres in town.
The Buffalo Sabre is in town. Shout out The Office.
Sabre. It's a good pull. That's a good pull. Shout out to everybody over in the YouTube chat as well. We'll chat with you tomorrow when the Oilers look to nab another victory on this homestand. Thanks for tuning in. A big shout out to all our partners for helping out with today's show as well. Have a good Wednesday. We'll talk again tomorrow.
Goodbye.
Thank you for watching Oilers Nation Every Day. Hit the subscribe button to never miss a show. And for more, visit OilersNation.com.